right, good morning. Good to see everybody here today, and I'm glad that you're able to join us, and have a few people that are visiting with us today. We're glad to have them. I won't make any Chick-fil-A jokes this week, all right? But it definitely is our pleasure to have a few of them with us today. And we're going to stand together. We're going to sing a couple of songs. It looks like we're going to sing At the Cross and Crown Him with Many Crowns. And then we have a video after that called The Hope of All Creation. And the couple that sings that song are going to be with us in the end of September. Mm-hmm. All right, end of September. They're going to be here on a Sunday morning, and they're going to do a mini concert for us. And their music's really wonderful. I'll give you more information about them in the coming weeks, but that'll be at the end of September. But one of the songs that they just came out with not too long ago called Hope of All Creation. And so we're going to sing that one today. And so I hope that you'll enjoy the worship this morning. And in a few minutes, we're going to be back in 1 Samuel. And I'm going to finish up a message that I started last week about don't listen to your heart. And so we'll finish that up here in a little bit. But thanks for being here today. Let's stand together and let's sing At the Cross.
Cross at the cross where I first saw light. Scripture reading.
Quiet in here. Morning, church family. I genuinely look forward to seeing you every week. That's true. That's very true. We're going to read in Hebrews chapter 7, we'll end at verse 16, but I had to read it a few times to kind of get it, so I recommend going home and reading through it a few times, maybe looking at a commentary or two. But I prayed about it and read, and what the writer of Hebrews is comparing in this passage is Christ. He's talking about Christ's priesthood, and he's in a way comparing it to that of Melchizedek of the time. And though Christ is not from a priestly tribe or family, he's saying that Christ's priesthood will be of higher order and a higher dispensation or covenant than the one they're seeing then. So that kind of seemed to help as I was reading along. But if you want to follow along, it's Hebrews chapter 7, starting in verse 1. For this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation king of righteousness, and after that also king of Salem, which is king of peace, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth of the spoils. And verily that they are of the sons of Levi, who receive the office of the priesthood, and have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of their loins of Abraham. But he whose descendant is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham, and blessed him that had the promises. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. And here men that die receive tithes, but there he receiveth them, of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. And as I may say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abraham. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. In verse 11, if therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, that further need was there, that another priest should not be called after the order of Aaron. For the priesthood being changed, there is made necessary a change also of the law under Christ. Verse 13, for he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe, of which no man gave attendance at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake, nothing concerning priesthood. And it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there ariseth another priest, who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life.
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. We like to see you too on Sundays. How many likes to see Brother Cameron on Sundays? All right, a few. Oh, one that doesn't even know you is clapping. How about that? Once he gets to know you, he may not clap. Amen. All right. Well, I'm glad that you're here today. I just want to give you a quick couple announcements. On Sunday nights, we start our Awana program. So that starts tonight at 6 o'clock. So all you kids 2 years old through 12th grade, we have Awanas start tonight. Tonight is just like a kickoff with an ice cream thing. So you're not even going to do anything tonight. You're going to eat ice cream. All right. And I think you eat ice cream and then they're taking you outside and doing something with you. I don't know what they're doing. We have a graveyard out back. So parents, all right, for a small price. No, I'm just kidding. We don't do that here. But anyways, that starts tonight. Also, starting tonight will be our Bible assembly group, those that be back there putting together Bibles that go overseas to countries that don't have as much access to the Word of God as we'd have. So they'll be back there tonight. And then I'll be teaching a class in the auditorium here. We're going to be talking about some current events and how it relates to us as believers and how Christians should respond and that kind of thing. So that'll be tonight. All that's going on at 6 o'clock, so we invite you to come back tonight at 6, all right? Thank you to the ladies that came out yesterday. They had a ladies' meeting. I heard that a couple of you had a good time anyway. I haven't heard from everybody, but a couple of you had a really good time, and I'm glad that that went well. Appreciate my wife for doing that. A week from this Thursday, we're taking all the young people, all the youth to laser tag over on Scallywag Tag over on the west side of town. We're leaving here at 2 o'clock. If you know any young person that wants to go with us, let me know. We'll make sure they get on the list. It'll be 2 o'clock to 7 o'clock. We're eating pizza on the way home. So that's a week from this coming Thursday. All right. And so I want you to be aware of all of those things. At this time, I believe the ladies have a couple more songs that they want to sing with us. So if you'd stand with them. And we're going to sing, is this new, Behold Our God? Have we sang this yet? This is a new song, so you may not know it. It's called Behold Our God. Let's stand together. And then His Mercy Is More. We'll sing that one. I think God has mercies more, don't you? I tell you, anybody that thinks they have their life put together needs to go back and really look. We're all messed up. Maybe you don't believe that. So we're all messed up. Is that right or wrong? We all need mercy. We all need it. I tell you, the problem is we all get to the point we think we don't need it. And we're all sinners. Matter of fact, if you go to Romans, it says that we do the things that we know that we shouldn't do, and we don't do the things that we know we should do. Why? Because we have a sin nature that we battle against every day. And I thank God we needed mercy to get saved, and thank God for His mercy after salvation. All of the Christian life is just a thing of mercy. If you come to church because you think that you're something spiritual, you need to think about it again, because there's nobody in here that's special. The Bible says that your best works are as filthy rags. Think about that. The best things that you can do in the eyes of God, they're filthy rags. It means we're incapable. We need the mercy of God. I got up this morning and I thanked God for His mercy. I'll get up tomorrow and I'll thank God for His mercy. Why? Because I mess up all the time. All the time. And so the biggest reason that I mess up, and probably the biggest reason that Brother Cameron messes up, and probably the biggest reason why many of us mess up, is the subject that we're going to look at today. Last week we started it, and if you have your Bibles, open them with me to 1 Samuel chapter 27. 1 Samuel chapter 27. And I want to give you a phrase on why we mess up so much in our lives. Why do we mess up? 1 Samuel chapter 27 and verse 1. The Bible says, "And David said in his heart." You know, oftentimes we mess up because we listen to what our heart is telling us. Now, the Bible does say to hide God's word in your where? Heart. That I might not sin against God. And so I'm not saying that sometimes that our heart doesn't know what's right. But I'll tell you this, anytime that you do wrong, it's not because you're listening to God, it's because you're listening to your heart. And David says in his heart, following your heart will lead to all kinds of problems. And I want to give you just a quick rundown of the things that we talked about last week, and they all start with D, all right? Following David's heart led him into despair, He thought he would perish in Saul's hands. The despair led to deception. He says, Saul's going to kill me, so what am I going to do? I've got to find a way to figure this out. So he decided, I'm going to deceive. He's living in a place he probably should have never been living in anyway. He's living down with the Philistines. The Philistines were the enemy of God. They did not love God. They were constantly fighting and going to war against God's people, Israel. And so David's living down with his men in a place called Ziklag. He went down. He's scared of Saul, so he goes down to the Philistines, to King Achish, and he says, will you give me a place that we can stay? So King Achish gives him a place, a piece of land called Ziklag, and so David goes out and makes raids every day, raiding people, and the Bible says that that King Achish asks David one day who he's been out raiding, and David tells him that he's been out killing Jews. He said, I've been out raiding the armies of Israel. I've been out killing Jews. I've been out killing my own people, which was a lie. He had not been doing that. He had been killing the other people, but not his own people. And David even made sure to kill the women so that the women couldn't squeal on him in any way, right? And David knew. He said, man, if I don't kill these women, they're going to talk, right? Because that's what women do. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not going to go there. All right. So verse 11 of chapter 27 says, and David saved neither man nor woman alive to bring tidings to Gath, saying, lest they should tell on us. So, us saying, so did David, and so will be his manner all the while he dwelleth in the country of the Philistines. So David's deception was followed by a dilemma. The dilemma is in chapters 28 and 29. King Achish wants David to come and go to war with him. He says, hey, you've already been out killing the Jews. You've already been out fighting against Israel. Let's go do it together. And David's like, oops, I got caught. Now what am I going to do? And so, chapter 29, the princes of the Philistines, they came and they talked to Achish and they said that we don't want to go to war with David. What if David ends up getting right with Saul and now he turns around and fights us? Remember, David's a valiant man of war, and we don't want to end up accidentally fighting against him. And so they outlined some convincing reasons, and King Achish sends David and his men back to Ziklag, which was the land given to David and his men to dwell in. And this is where we came to David's disaster. After David had been deceiving, he comes back to Ziklag. The city's burned down. The women are gone. The wives are gone. The children are gone. Possessions are gone. Cattle's gone. Everything that they owned is either burned or gone. The Bible tells us that David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And then the people become so upset, they talked about stoning David. Well, we're going to stone David. He led us into this mess. And so David does something. He makes a decision. He goes from a disaster to a decision. And he decides to go to a different source than he went to the first time. Instead of listening to his heart, I want you to go with me to 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 6. 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 6. Instead of listening to his heart, 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 6 says, "But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God." You know what? I tell you what, we need mercy because we listen to our heart way too much. And David comes to a point in his life where he looks and he says, I need to go back to the source of truth. I need to go back to the one who's right. I need to go back to the one that has it all figured out. And he goes and he encourages himself in the Lord. David didn't follow his heart this time. He inquired of the Lord. And when he inquires of the Lord, we see the grace and the mercy of God, and God tells David to go and pursue the people that took his wives and his children and all of their possessions. And he tells him, he says, "You will recover it all. You're going to get it all back, David," because he did what was right. He's going to get it all back. And God tells David to pursue, and it leads us to our thought today. I'm going to pick up where I left off last week. We went from disaster to deliverance, all right? Today we're going to talk about David's deliverance. 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 9. The Bible says this in 1 Samuel chapter 30 and verse 9. So David went, he and 600 men that were with him, and came to the brook Besor, where those that were left behind stayed. But David pursued, he and 400 men, for 200 abode behind, which were so faint that they could not go over the brook Besor. And they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David and gave him bread, and he did eat, and they made him drink water. And they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. And when they had eaten, his spirit came to him again. For he had not eaten no bread nor drunk any water 3 days and three nights. And David said to him, "To whom belongest thou? And whence art thou?" And he said, "I am a young man of Egypt, servant to an Amalekite, and my master left me because 3 days ago I fell sick. We made an invasion upon the south of the Cherethites, and upon the coast which belongeth to Judah, and upon the south of Caleb, and we burned," you ready for it, "Ziklag with fire." This guy had been part of burning the town that David and his men lived in. That means this guy had been part of taking the women and the children and the animals. And David said to him, "Canst thou bring me down to this company? Can you take me back to your army?" And he said, "Swear unto me by God that thou wilt neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, and I will bring thee down to this company." Man, I tell you what, this story is better than any plot that Hallmark ever came out with. Amen. I mean, think about the twists and the turns. I mean, Hallmark's predictable, right? Man thinks she loves, or woman thinks she loves man. She finds another man, doesn't love this man, loves this man. It's all over. Every time, same thing. This story, I tell you, something else. I mean, David's going to battle. The men turn on him. He goes back. His city's burned. people are gone. He says, God tells him to pursue. He pursues. And in the middle of the trail, he finds one that his master was the one that was involved in burning down his town. He says, can you get me to him? Guy says, yes, but don't kill me and don't turn me back over to my master. I mean, this story is something else. This guy gets sick. His master leaves him behind to die. And David asks him if he knows where the Amalekites are. Man says, yes. He says, I'll tell you. I'll take you there, but don't kill me and don't turn me over to my master. And I want you to understand this morning. If you're taking notes, you can write it down. The beginning of deliverance starts when you turn to God. The beginning of deliverance starts when you turn to God. Because David had followed his heart, he got himself in a mess. When David followed his heart, things were not going the way they should go. When David followed his heart, things were happening to the people of God that shouldn't have been happening. And so David got himself in a mess. But the key to getting back on track was turning back to the Lord. And people don't understand this in our world today. People get all messed up in all kinds of things, and we won't get into what all those things are, but people get messed up in so many different things. And they go down and they follow their heart and they say, well, this feels right and it looks right and I think it's going to make me happy, and so I'm going to pursue this. And they do, and they wake up one day, and all of a sudden they're in a mess. And then they think, well, man, I messed up. God's over there with a rod. He's ready to beat me, and there's no way I can go back over there because somebody said it in Sunday school today, I'm going to be judged by Christians. I'm going to be judged by churches. God's going to judge me, whatever the case may be. So we're in a mess. I can't go back over there because I'm going to be judged. But I'm going to tell you something. God's not that way. When God died on the cross for your sins, he died for the ones from the past, he died for the ones from the present, and he died for the ones in the future. He died for them all. And there ain't nothing that you're going to do that's going to make God love you any more than God already loves you. And oftentimes, what we have to realize is that when we're in the mess, the first step to getting out of that mess is simply just turning back to God. God never left you. He never forsook you. He's always been there. David followed his heart. He got himself in a mess. But the key to getting back on track was turning back to the Lord. Many people in their lives, they've gotten themselves into a mess. They've tried to figure things out on their own. They tried to make decisions they thought were best. And sometimes, once we're in that mess, we think God doesn't love us anymore. There's no hope for me. But just like how God shows mercy to David, thank God his mercy is more to us. His mercy is more. When we turn back to the Lord, what we find out is that God had never left us. He never abandoned us. He was right there all the time. The problem is the fact that it's hard to recognize and see his presence in our lives when we're focused on ourselves. When I'm sitting there trying to think what makes sense for me, what do I want to do? What does my heart say? God never left me, but I'm not focused on him. I don't see him. I've ignored him. I've pushed him out. But Jesus never abandoned David. In fact, the Lord knew that David would turn back to him at this point because God knows everything. You say, well, preacher, I'm trying hard to do what's right, and I'm trying hard to live right, but man, I messed up and I stumbled. God knew you were going to do that. God knew you were going to mess up. That's why his mercy is more. I love the sovereignty of God in this story. God allowed these Amalekites to come in and plunder Ziklag. When he did that, he made sure that they did not harm anything or lose anything. And when David and his men are pursuing the men who destroyed their homes and took their families captive, they encounter a sick man who was placed there by the providence of God Almighty. God made sure that man was sick. He made sure he was on the path right when David came along. And there's so much more to this story than just David and his men chasing their attackers. I want you to see a picture here today, and I hope that you'll see it. There's a picture here of the great love and mercy of a holy God for fallen men. In these verses, we can see a portrait of the Lord Jesus and his compassion for the sinner. I want you to think about this D with me. David finds a detractor. David finds a detractor. We see in this chapter today a detractor who finds mercy. You never see David being a blessing to someone while he is following his heart, not the Lord. But once David inquires of the Lord and starts doing things God's way, he becomes a blessing, or you could say he becomes salvation to a detractor. And I want you to take a moment. I want you to look at the situation with me of this detractor. Now, first of all, if you understand anything about the Old Testament or the Bible, there's pictures in the Old Testament. Does anybody know what oftentimes David is a picture of in the Old Testament? Shout it out. Christ. He's a picture of the Lord. Does anybody know what picture the Philistines are? What picture, what portrait do they paint for us? I can't hear. Somebody shout it out. There's no wrong answers. Enemy of God. All right? So if David is a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Philistines are a picture of the enemy of God, I want you to think about that with me. Look at verse 11, back of chapter 30 and verse 11 of 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 11. The Bible says this. And they found an Egyptian in the field and brought him to David and gave him bread and he did eat, and they made him to drink water. The first thing I want you to notice about this detractor is this. He's a foreigner. This man is a stranger to the promises of God. He doesn't have the hope that Israel has. Egypt is representative of the world. Egypt is representative of the enemy of God. The Egyptian is in this story here is a picture of the world. He is a foreigner to the things of God. Somebody that's never been born again. Somebody that's never been repentant of their sins and turned to Christ for salvation. They are a foreigner to the things of God, to the promises of God. I too was a foreigner to the family of God. There was a time in my life I was stranger to the promises of God. There was a time in my life when my feet were standing in the miry clay. But there was a point in my life when God's mercy reached down and I cried out to the Lord and said, I need forgiveness, Lord. And he reached down and he forgave me and he took my feet out of that miry clay and he placed them in a solid and sure foundation. You see, this man here, he's lost. He's a foreigner. But not only is he a foreigner, he was famished. Look at verse 12. The Bible says in chapter 30 and verse 12, it says, and they gave him a piece of cake of figs and two clusters of raisins. I think I'd have starved to death. Amen. And when he had eaten, his spirit came unto him again. And they didn't give him no Chick-fil-A sandwiches. They gave him some figs. Amen. And two clusters of raisins. If you ever are about ready to die, that's what you need to eat right there. Bring you back to life. Amen. He was famished. He was literally starving to death. All right? He had not eaten no bread, not drunk any water, 3 days, 3 nights. The world will never satisfy a longing soul. I want you to understand that. He was famished. There's people all over our country today, they're famished. Why? Because they're chasing their heart. My heart says to do this. I don't need God anymore. Told our young people today, about 3 or 4 years ago, for the first time in American history, we are no longer a Christian nation. We've turned our back on God. 48% or less of Americans, a nation that was founded on the Bible and the Word of God, less than 48% now even believe that there's a God. And we are living in a land that is famished. People are spiritually starving to death. I want you to understand something. There is pleasure in sin for a season. The world will satisfy temporarily. But it's gonna leave you hungry. It's gonna leave you famished. The sinner will never find fulfillment in the arms of the world. It'll only find fulfillment in the person of Jesus Christ. That's the only place of rest and perfect satisfaction. In one of the greatest sermons ever preached, Jesus said this, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. In one of the greatest evangelistic endeavors recorded in history in the Bible, Jesus tells the woman at the well, whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of springing up into everlasting life. You know why Americans are afraid to die in 2021? Because they don't know where they're going when they die. They've not experienced the gift of salvation that produces eternal life. Jesus says you can drink water, but that's going to satisfy you temporarily. But the water I'm going to give you is going to satisfy you for all eternity. The psalmist says in Psalm 142 verse 4, I looked on my right hand and beheld there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. The prodigal son understood what it was like. Oh, I just jumped ahead of myself. I'm sorry. Number three, he was a foreigner. He was famished. But number three, he was friendless. Look at verse 13. And David said unto him, to whom belongest thou? And whence art thou come? And he said, I am a young man of Egypt, servant to an Amalekite, and my master left me because 3 days ago I fell sick. This man didn't have a friend. He was left for dead. The Bible says in verse 13 that his master left him there. He'd been sick for 3 days. After all this time, this man had served his master. The moment that he doesn't seem to have any value because of his sickness, what happens? Gets cast aside. Well, we use this guy as much as we could use him. Now he's no good to us, so we're going to let him die. This guy was a foreigner. He was famished. He was friendless. You know what? That's exactly how much the devil values your life and mine. He delights in using us up. He delights in throwing us away. And the sinner only has one true friend. His name is Jesus. Many will pretend to be your friend, but Jesus is the only one that died so that you could have eternal life. The psalmist said in Psalm 142 and verse 4, I looked on my right hand and beheld there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. He was friendless. No man cared for my soul. He was friendless. The prodigal son knew what it was like to have friends until they had nothing left to offer him. And then what did they do? They cast him aside. Could you imagine coming across your inheritance, going out and having a bunch of friends, partying, paying for everything. Your friends coming, man, John, you're so good. Man, you're so good. Man, I'm glad I'm your friend. You're my friend, man, until the death. We're buds. We're going to do some little blood brother things, right? Whatever. His prodigal son ran out of money. What did his friends do? They cast him aside. They didn't even care for him when they saw him eating slop out of a pig pen. This boy got in such a mess that he couldn't even buy a meal. So they said, well, there's the pig pen you can eat out there with the pigs. Where was his friends? You see, you think you have friends. But not a single one of your friends did anything for the sin debt that you owe. Only God did. Many will pretend to be your friend, but Jesus is the only one that died so that you could have eternal life. But not only do I want you to see the situation of this detractor, I want you to see the Savior of this detractor. Remember, as we go through this passage, that David is a type of Christ. It is a picture. Verse 11, the Bible says he found him. It says they found an Egyptian in the field. Can I say this? No sinner can truthfully say that he has found Jesus. It is the Lord who does the looking. It is the Lord who does the finding. It is the Lord that does the awakening and shows you your need of salvation. John chapter 6 and verse 44, the Bible says, no man came to me except the Father which hath sent me. Draw him, and I will raise him up at that last day. No man can come to me except the Father which hath sent me draw him. You know what? God this morning is looking to draw sinners to himself. God this morning is looking to find some Egyptian, some person that's lost in the world, and find him and draw him to himself. God has people in the field that he's drawing to himself. The Bible says, say not ye that there are yet 4 months and then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. God is out there drawing people to himself, and it is his desire that us as believers go out there and take the gospel and share it with those at whom he's drawing. I have a responsibility, and you have a responsibility, and we might say, well, Pastor, I can't talk to people about God. I'm fearful to talk to people about God. But the Bible says that the fields are white. There's people that are, in essence, like this man that are laying in the path, and they're foreigners, and they're famished, and they need somebody to come along and tell them what Jesus Christ did for them on the cross. I want you to see the Savior. The Savior, David, found this man, but also he fed him. Verses 11 and 12, David and his men met the need of this man. I want you to know something this morning. Jesus, when he is received, meets the greatest need of every human. The need of the soul. He brings salvation. He brings forgiveness. He brings eternal life. He satisfies the deepest longings of the heart of the man. So we see the Savior, but I want you to see this. I want you to see the salvation of this detractor. David freed this man. His life was changed after he met David. Notice what David delivered him from. Go back in chapter 30 there and look down around verse 15. And David said to him, canst thou bring me down to this company? And he said, swear unto me by God that thou wilt neither kill me nor deliver me into the hands of my master, and I will bring thee down to this company. We see salvation from slavery here. You know what, as humans, you know what we are enslaved to? We're enslaved to sin. Jesus sets the captives free. We see salvation from death. The man would have surely died, but David brought him life. You know, the Christian need never to fear death. I told our kids in Sunday school today, the reason why death, the fear of death, is at an all-time high in our country is because it's in direct correlation to the fact that our belief in God is at an all-time low. I'm telling you what, people have never feared death like they fear death right now. I'm not going to get up here and tell you one thing or the other. You want to go get a vaccine, go get a vaccine. You want to wear a mask, you go wear a mask. It's everybody's right to go do what they feel like they need to do. But let me tell you something. The one thing that you should never do as a believer is fear death. You shouldn't fear death. We are doing everything that we can to make sure that we cushion ourselves. What can I do to protect myself to make sure that I live another year longer? Why don't you just get out and start doing what God has for your life and trust him? I mean, we're so consumed. I mean, before long, everybody's going to be walking around in bubble wrap. I'm waiting for it. I might actually start promoting it. Amen. I mean, man, people, bubble wrap will give me another extra week of life. Yes! I'll become a millionaire selling bubble wrap. Amen. But this detractor, he would have died, but David brought him life. He's been delivered through Jesus. Purpose. Here was a man who was used up, thought his life was over. David gave him new life and a new future. And Jesus rescues us from the scrap pile and puts us in the King's service. The Bible says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus, unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. You see, you don't have to be defeated this morning. You don't have to be dead in your trespasses and sins. You don't have to be left on the side of the road after you've been used up by the world. God will save you, and he'll give you a purpose in which to live, and he'll save you so that you can do good works, and that you can bring glory to him, and that you can have eternal life. I mean, serving, there's nothing better, in my opinion, than serving Jesus. People think I got the most boring job in all of the world. You have no clue. Follow me around one day. You have the time of your life. You have the time of your life. Jesus rescued me from the scrap pile. I was low, and I was in the miry clay, and I had no hope in my life. I had no purpose for which to live. My purpose was, can I get 70 years? My purpose was, can I get 80 years? My purpose was, can I put some bubble wrap on and get another week out of life? But when Jesus saved me, man, it don't matter no more. When this life ends, eternity begins. And I get to continue doing, if I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing, I get to continue doing for all of eternity what I'm doing right now. Trying to bring glory to Jesus. Only one day it's going to be a lot easier, because you're going to have a new body, and there's not going to be any sin, and God's going to wipe it all clean, and you're going to get to sit around the throne of heaven for all of eternity and worshiping and praising, but you'll have a good voice. Amen. I try to sing down here and everybody says, shut up. But up there, nobody's going to tell me to shut up. Amen. We were his workmanship. We're created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. I don't know many things this morning, but there's one thing I do know for sure. I know that I'm saved. Now, listen to me. That doesn't mean I'm perfect. Man, I'm so messed up. You don't believe me? Talk to my wife. You don't believe her? Talk to my kids. You don't believe them? Talk to Daniel. He tells all in our family. Amen. I'm so messed up, but I know I'm saved. I know that Jesus came to where I was lying broken, where I was wasting. I'll tell you this story and I'm done. When we were living in Peru, we planted a church in a province of Lince, rough area, alcoholics everywhere. I can't even describe it to you. The stench of this town. We had a church. It was in a little two-car garage. And we were getting ready to have church. And across the street, there's drunk people just laying in their own vomit. Right across the street from the church. Everybody walks to church because you don't have vehicles unless you take public transportation. People everywhere, just a mess. Just a mess. And I started noticing my people in the church coming, and man, they thought they were something special. They had their shirt and ties on, walking to church, walking right by all these people. So, one week I asked my assistant pastor, well, I say assistant pastor, we were grooming him to be the pastor of the church that we were planning there. He was a Peruvian man, and his name was Ephraim. And I said to Ephraim, I said, I got a sermon I want to preach this Sunday, but I need your help. He said, what do you need? I said, well, I need you to go find some clothes, and we're going to cut them up. And I said, I need you to go somewhere and roll around in some dirt for a little bit. I said, I need you to find a way to make your clothes stinky. Amen. We put some beer on him, left a bottle sitting by him, put him from that corner of the pew right there to the front door of the church. You had to trip over him to get inside the church. Next Sunday come along, everybody come in their shirt and ties, come walking in. Hey, pastor, how are you doing? Doing all right. Song service went through, everybody's singing, and got up to preach. And I was talking about our need of salvation, and I was talking about the fact that we're all sinners, and that we're all broken and that we're all a mess and that we're all wasted. And I said, you know, but the problem is that we think that we're all saints. We think we're perfect. We think because we come to church, we got it all together. And I said, I just want to ask a question. I said, did anybody see anybody laying in front of the church this morning? They're all like, oh, yeah, preacher, we saw him. At least he could have went up the street, not laid right in front of the church. So I asked one of the men in the church, I said, could somebody go out there and bring that man in here? Somebody looked at me really weird, like, what do you mean bring that man in here? Go ahead and bring that man in here, would you? Went out, grabbed him, brought him in, brought him up to the front. And he took the hat that was over his head off, and everybody realized it was the assistant pastor of the church. I asked Ephraim, I said, did anybody invite you to church today? He said, no. I said, did anybody go out there and offer you a cup of water or a hot meal? He said, no. People in my church were weeping. And I looked at them and I said, that's the same mess that God saved you from. We forget. We think, well, I was a pretty good person before I met Christ. Uh-uh. Your righteousness is, we're as filthy rags. We're all messed up. We all need Jesus Christ. I'm so glad that he saved me, but just because he saved me doesn't make me anything special other than the fact that I'm a child of the King. I mean, that's special, but what I'm saying is I'm not more important than anybody else in this room. I know he saved me, and I know he's given me new life, and I know that I'm grateful. I know that I love him. I know that I didn't deserve that. And I want to say this morning. Thank God he lifts the fallen. Thank God he delivers the captives. Thank God he helps the burdened. Thank God that he saves the sinners. And I want to say this morning, I thank God that I was found one day. What about you? Have you met Jesus? Have you started a relationship with him? I don't care if you go to church or not. That's not my business. I don't care if you're perfect or not. I know you're not perfect. Amen. But are you saved? Do you know that you're going to heaven? You know, there's a lot that we could take out of that story. But instead of just focusing on David chasing around these men that took his stuff, I'd rather focus on the fact that God came and he delivered you. He delivered me. Thank God for that this morning. Let's pray. Dear Lord, pray that you would help us this morning. Pray that you'd help us, Lord. I don't know what the spiritual needs are in this church, Lord. I don't know, Lord, what people are going through this morning. I know that you know. Lord, I know that we're all dealing with something in our lives, and Lord, I pray that you'd help us with whatever that is. Lord, help us to be grateful, Lord, if we've met you already. Lord, help us to be grateful for that. Help us to be committed to taking the gospel message to those who don't know. Lord, there's nothing more tragic than to have the cure for cancer and keep it a secret. But there's nothing more tragic than to have the cure for death and eternal life and keep that a secret. Lord, I hope that we won't keep you the biggest secret in town, Lord, that we'll be quick to share what you did on the cross with everybody that we meet. Lord, help people know they can have forgiveness of sins, or they can have eternal life. Well, that's a promise that we find in your word. Lord, we pray that you'd help us with that. Peradventure, Lord, there's one here this morning that doesn't know you as their personal Savior. Lord, may today be the day that they trust in you. Lord, may today be the day that they repent of their sins, turn away from their heart, and turn to you. Lord, we'll thank you and praise you for it. We ask this in your precious name. With heads bowed and eyes closed, no one looking around for just a moment, I want to ask you a question. I want to ask you a question. Have you met Jesus? Are you right with God this morning? Have you had a time in your life where you've repented of your sins? Repent means to turn away from, not just say you're sorry. We say we're sorry when we got caught. Repentance means to turn away from it and say, I'm not going to do that anymore. I'm going to turn to Jesus Christ. I'm going to turn to the Word of God. I'm going to do what the Bible says. I'm going to be obedient to Him. this morning. Is there a time in your life you've done that? If not, could I encourage you? Just a moment, we're going to have a time of invitation. And it means I just want to invite you to come. I'd love to take the Word of God. We'll go out back somewhere, whatever the case, wherever you want to go, we'll take the Word of God. Show you what it means to be saved. I invite you to come. Just meet me in the front and we'll go somewhere and see what the Bible says about being saved and having eternal life. Maybe you're here and you are saved. You know that you're saved. Maybe there's some other things that are going on in your life. Maybe you've been following your heart in some different areas and you need to turn back to the Lord. You need to seek the Lord. I encourage you to come and make some decisions to Him today. Just ask Him to help you. Say, God, help me as I try not to follow my heart. I try to follow your will. Help me in that, Lord. That's what we need this morning. So we're going to stand together. We're going to have a verse of invitation. Heidi's going to help us. I invite you to come. If you need to come, why don't you come? I'll be down here in the front. You can meet me here. I'll be glad to pray with you. I'll be glad to take you to the Word of God, help you, whatever I can do. But if you need to come this morning, why don't you come as Heidi sings? Have our men come to take our offering this morning. I want to say thank you for your faithfulness to giving. If you're visiting with us today, we don't ask for money. That's not why we're here, so don't feel any obligation to give. This is for our church family that to give, and it meets the needs of our community, and we thank you for that. Look forward to all that's going on in our community this Saturday at 6 or at 10 o'clock. Is it 10 o'clock, Chris? What time's Grace Fest start? 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock this Saturday, we'll be down at Batavia giving some school supplies out to kids and stuff, getting ready for that. So all the money for that's already taken care of. All the pencil bags and all that stuff's been bought. We thank the Lord for it. All kinds of stuff going on. The welcoming team has an announcement in just a minute. But I just want to say thank you for your faithfulness to give. Let's have a word of prayer. Ask the Lord to bless the offering. And Brother Jeff, would you say a prayer over the offering this morning.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this.
You got an announcement for us? All right. Get ready. Get your mic ready. All right. I got two, and then you can have it. Tomorrow morning, Reba's mom passed away this past week, and the funeral for her mom is tomorrow. Layout is from 9 to 11 at Nuri's here in Amelia. Service starts at 11. So if you would, I know many of you will have to work tomorrow and you can't be there, but be praying for Reba's family. Tomorrow at 9 to 11 as they bury her mom. And then ladies, if you have not got with Miss Connie, I know they're trying to get some ladies to get some food put together. They're having a lunch for the family back here afterwards, after the funeral. So that's tomorrow. So if you can help with cooking for any of that, we would appreciate that. Wednesday's groups, want to encourage you to be here on Wednesday for our missions groups. All the posters on the side of the room represent all of our different groups, and my group, we've been going out in the community hanging door hangers all week or all month, so we've enjoyed that. In preparation for tonight, tonight starts our Awana program, and so like I said, if you got a kid in the Awana program, have them here tonight at 6. Where's Miss Naomi? Do we have the registration and everything tonight too? Are we going to have that set up, or is that going to be next week? All right, whichever I prefer. If you want to get your kid registered, we'll do that. We'll have that tonight set up. It'll be down inside the bottom of the steps when you come in the door. And then tonight is ice cream night, so all the kids, if there's any ice cream left over, we'll let the adults have some. So I don't know. The kids might destroy it all. How many gallons of ice cream did we buy? Like 17,000 gallons. So tonight, 6 o'clock for that. And then I will be 2 weeks from today. My family, we're leaving on vacation. We'll be gone for a week, so I will not be here 2 weeks from today. My brother-in-law is going to be in town, and he's going to preach for me that day. So my brother-in-law will be preaching. If you guys beg him, he might get his daughter to sing that day, all right, which is Addie. How many remember Addie from a couple weeks ago? She did our concert for us. Matter of fact, we could just write it into the thing that he's not allowed to preach unless she sings. We could do it that way. But anyways, that's 2 weeks from today. So I hope that you'll be aware of that. And then can you cut my live stream off for just a second? Just to not publicize this.